In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Through the grace of God, we will study tonight the last chapter from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans, chapter 16. In this chapter, St. Paul concludes his letter with miscellaneous instructions, greetings, warning, and at the end, a doxology, a praise, a hymn of praise to God. The first two verses are his comments concerning Phoebe, a deaconess or a servant of the church in Cenchrea. Also, in verse 3-5, he spoke about Priscilla and Aquila, sending them his greetings, and also explaining how instrumental this couple was in the spread of the gospel. Then from verse 6-16, St. Paul conveyed his greetings to others in Rome who helped in the growth of the church. From verse 17-18, he gave a final warning against those who may cause division in the church. And also, he wanted to emphasize their continued obedience to the gospel of Christ. And then from verse 21-24, St. Paul's companion, those who were with him at Corinth, sent also their greetings to the church in Rome. And then he ended and concluded this epistle by a wonderful expression and a hymn of praise to God. So let's start reading verse by verse, and let us try to understand this chapter. Verse 1 and 2. I commend to you Phoebe, our sister, who is a servant of the church in Cenchrea, that you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and assist her in whatever business she has need of you. For indeed, she has been a helper of many and of myself also. It is evident that Phoebe was the bearer of the letter. She carried the letter when she went to Rome. She delivered the letter of St. Paul to the church in Rome. Phoebe was a Christian and also served in the church as a deaconess. Because the word servant, when he said, I commend to you Phoebe, our sister, he called her our sister because she is a sister in Christ, a believer. And this shows the humbleness of St. Paul, how he calls his disciple Phoebe his sister. But he described her by saying, who is a servant of the church in Cenchrea. Servant in Greek, the word is diakonia. So she was a deaconess. She was a deaconess, which actually makes us know that in the early church, even in the time of St. Paul, there were deaconesses in the church, and St. Paul, in giving her a recommendation, mentioned her office as a deaconess. And it's interesting to notice that in this chapter, chapter 16, in this list of the persons greeted, a number of women are mentioned. And the greetings show how highly St. Paul actually esteemed women's ministry in the church. It's very clear that there were many, many active women in ministry in the church. And this explains to us the importance of the service of the women in the church, although they cannot serve in the capacity of priesthood, but there are many, many activities they can participate in it. St. Paul actually wrote this letter to Rome when he was in Corinth. And Centuria, the church in which Phoebe was serving as a deaconess, was its seaport, the seaport of Corinth, on the Aegean Sea, about 9 miles from the city. And now there is a small town with the old name still marks its site. In verse 2, he told them that you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints. So he is telling them, you are called to be saints. So when Phoebe comes to you, receive her and give her a Christian welcome. The Christians are expected to host the strangers. So Phoebe is not actually a stranger. She is a sister in Christ, a servant in the church. That's why he is asking them to receive her and welcome her in a Christian manner as a way worthy or in a manner worthy of the saints. And the word business that he mentioned here, and assist her in whatever business she has need of you, the Greek word suppose that she was visiting Rome for a legal business. So a legal business called her to Rome. That's why he is asking them to assist her in whatever business she has need of you. And it also very clear that Phoebe helped many, many Christians and also helped St. Paul himself. As he said, for indeed she has been a helper of many and of myself also. So as a deaconess, she helped many. Among those, she ministered to St. Paul himself. So from these two verses, there is a lesson to us. When somebody comes to visit us from outside the local church, we should receive him in a Christian way, in a manner worthy of saints, because we are called to be saints, and help him or her in whatever they need, and assist them, because this is our obligation toward one another. In the same way, when newcomers come to our area, it is our responsibility to provide them with the need. It's our responsibility to assist them to be established, to help them in looking for work until they are established. Again, this is obligation, a Christian obligation toward one another as members in the body of Christ. From verse 3, he spoke about another couple, Priscilla and Aquila. Verse 3, he said, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. Why St. Paul described Priscilla and Aquila as fellow workers? Because they helped St. Paul in his ministry at Corinth, as we read in Acts chapter 18, verse 2. Then actually, they went to Ephesus and prepared the way for his work and his service there in Ephesus, as we read in Acts chapter 18, verse 26. And after they helped him in Corinth and in Ephesus, they returned to Rome, their former home. Rome was a home for Priscilla and Aquila. So after they helped St. Paul in Corinth and in Ephesus, they returned to Rome. So St. Paul is sending his greeting here to Priscilla and Aquila, and he described them, my fellow workers in Christ. And the fact that the name of the wife comes before the name of the husband, and also they were mentioned in the same order in Acts chapter 18, verse 2, this implies that she was the more efficient, more active in the ministry. And also Priscilla and Aquila were mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 19, and in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 19. They did not only help St. Paul in his ministry, but also, as St. Paul said in verse 4, they risked their own necks for my life. Who risked their own necks for my life. So it's evident that at some time they had endured great hardship and peril for St. Paul's sake. And not only for St. Paul, but for other Christians in the churches of the Gentiles. That's why St. Paul said, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. So all the churches of the Gentiles are giving thanks to Priscilla and Aquila for their help, for their zeal, for how they risked their life for the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this actually shows the love that we should have to one another. Priscilla and Aquila risked their life to help St. Paul and to help the churches of the Gentiles. That's why the churches of the Gentiles feel they are under a debt of gratitude to them. Also, because the early church, they didn't have established churches like us right now. There was no house of worship and house of prayer. They used to meet in the houses of the believers. And Priscilla and Aquila prepared their house to receive the believers. So their house was like a church. That's why in verse 5, St. Paul said, likewise greet the church that is in their house. Greet the church that's in their house. It's very good to learn from Priscilla and Aquila and to make also our houses church for God, to have a place of worship and a place of prayer in our houses. And when we meet together, maybe we can start our visit by a prayer or we open the scripture and read and study together. Because the houses of the believers should be like churches. Then St. Paul greeted another person. His name was Abentos. He said, "Greet my beloved Abentos, who is my first fruit of Achaia to Christ." Actually, this is the only place in which Abentos was mentioned in the Bible. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 15, we know that the family of Stephanas was the first convert in Achaia. But here St. Paul is saying about Epentos, he is the first fruit of Achaia to Christ. That's why we suppose that Epentos is a member of the family of Stephanas, the first convert of Achaia, as we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 15. Then actually from verse 6, he start to mention several names. And a large number of the names that St. Paul mentioned in verse 16, in chapter 16, were personal acquaintances of St. Paul. Some had rendered him special service, and many of them were his converts, those who believed by the preaching of St. Paul. And this shows us the spirit of love and fellowship in the early church. Can you imagine a whole chapter was dedicated just for greetings? Because the people had a bond of love. St. Paul, although he was very, very busy in his ministry, but he was able actually to touch the life of the people and to establish a personal relationship with everyone. And I like how he described the people here. For example, he called Epentos my beloved. So it is not just they are members in the church, but there are feelings, there are emotions, there are love, that there is love that's shared among the members of the church. In verse 6, he said, "Greet Mary, who labored much for us." Greet Mary, who labored much for us. Actually, many of these names, we know nothing about them, except that they were mentioned in this chapter. Although the people forgot what they did, but God did not forget their labor. That's why their name was recorded in the Bible. Maybe we don't know who is Mary that he greeted her in verse 6, and he said about her, "who labored much for us." We don't know anything about her, but God actually knows what she did, and he will reward her in the kingdom of heaven. And actually, he has her name written here. God has the name of Mary written here in the Bible. So if it was written in the Bible, for sure her name also is written in the book of life. So maybe our work or our labor will be forgotten by the people, but God will never forget our labor and our work, as he promised us even a cup of cold water that we offer to one of the needy will not be forgotten before God. Verse 7, he said, "Greet Andronicus and Junia, my countrymen and my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Andronicus and Junia, it's clear that they were from, they were Jewish. That's why he said, my countrymen. My countrymen means they are not converts. They are not of the churches of the Gentiles. They were Jewish. Fellow prisoners, although we don't know when they were present with St. Paul, but St. Paul say they were my fellow prisoners. All of them were imprisoned together for the name of Christ. And it's clear that they helped not only St. Paul, but also they ministered with others, apostles. That's why he said about them, who are of note among the apostles. So the apostles of Christ know them, recognize them, appreciate their ministry and their service. Then he said, who also were in Christ before me, as if St. Paul envies them for knowing Christ before him, as if St. Paul is groaning on the years that he spent away from Christ, not knowing Christ. So he said, these two persons were in Christ before me. I wish that I was in Christ also, as whole my life, not later in my life. In verse 8 he said, greet Ampelias, my beloved in the Lord. As I told you, he used a very powerful expression, my beloved in the Lord. It is an expression of dear Christian affection. Dear Christian affection. Verse 9, greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and Stachys, my beloved. When he said our fellow worker, why he used the word our? Why he didn't use the word my fellow worker? Because now he is joining Timothy with him. In the same chapter, verse 21, we read, Timothy, my fellow worker. So it is very clear that Urbanus was serving or ministering with Timothy and Paul. So Timothy and Paul together calling Urbanus our fellow worker in Christ. And again he used about Stachys the word my beloved to show his affection and his love in Christ. Verse 10, greet Apelles, approved in Christ. What he means by approved in Christ? He is referring to the trials and the hardships that he endured for the name of Christ, but he did not deny his faith. So his faith was tested and he was approved to be a faithful Christian. That's why he said approved in Christ, approved through trials, through hardships. Greet Apelles, approved in Christ. Greet those who are of the household of Aristobulus. Why he said household of Aristobulus? Why he did not include Aristobulus in this greeting? He's greeting his household. Maybe Aristobulus was either dead or not a believer. So maybe his family or his servants believed in Christ. That's why he was greeting the household. Or maybe Aristobulus was dead at this moment. And the word household can refer either to his family or most probably he referred to his servant. Many people in Rome, the prominent people in Rome, they used to have servants and slaves. And actually Christianity spread among these servants in the beginning. So maybe the servants of Aristobulus believed in Christ, and St. Paul is sending them his greeting. And this show also how St. Paul consider everybody, not only the rich and prominent people, but even the servants and the slaves, because everybody in Christ is equal. Verse 11, greet Herodion, my countryman. Greet those who are of the household of Narcissus, who are in the Lord. Herodion, the countryman, as I told you, the word countryman means he is Jewish. He is also Jewish. He is not from the Gentiles. And at the time St. Paul wrote his letter, a favorite of Nero, the emperor of Rome, named Narcissus, who was very, very powerful in the city of Rome. That's why he said, greet those who are of the household of Narcissus, who are in the Lord. Again, most probably, a great number of the servant of Narcissus believed in Christ and accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. And St. Paul is sending them his greeting. When he said, who are in the Lord, means who accepted Christ and believed in him. Then in verse 12 he said, greet Dryphena and Tryphosa, who have labored in the Lord. These are names of women, Tryphena and Tryphosa, who have labored in the Lord. As I told you, many women were mentioned in this chapter, which means the women had a very active role in the church. And maybe because he said, who labored in the Lord, maybe also Tryphena and Tryphosa were deaconesses, like Phoebe. Greet the beloved Persis, who labored much in the Lord. Also Persis is a deaconess, a female servant, most probably also she was a deaconess also, and he called her who labored much in the Lord, beloved Persis. Verse 13, greet Rufus. Rufus, most of the scholars agreed that he is the one who was mentioned in the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 15, verse 21. Simon of Cyrene, who carried the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, has a son, his name is Rufus. So this Rufus, most probably, the son of Simon of Cyrene, who carried the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ and was mentioned in Mark chapter 15, verse 21. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord. God chose him for ministry and for service, and his mother and mine. St. Paul definitely had met Rufus and had met his mother. That's why he called or described the mother of Rufus his own mother, his mother and mine. And again, this shows us the spirit of the first church. They feel like one family in the Lord, one family, the family of God. And actually in baptism, we become from the family of God. We join the family of God. And our relationship to one another is a relationship of a family. Verse 14. Greet Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Patrobas, Hermes, and the brethren who are with them. Again, he mentioned some names here. Maybe the only name that we recognize, Hermas. And many scholars of the Bible says Hermas is the author of the Shepherd of Hermas, one of the writings of the early church, the Apostolic Fathers. And actually this letter is available until now, the Shepherd of Hermas. So maybe this Hermas is the one who wrote this Shepherd of Hermas, and it is one of the letters that are gathered together and called the Apostolic Fathers, the writing of the Apostolic Fathers. Verse 15, greet Philologus and Julia, Nerus and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Most probably, this was also another household church, a church that gathered also in one of the houses. That's why he mentioned them together. Why we said most probably this was a church, because he said, and all the saints who are with them, all the saints who are with them in this household church. So maybe there was a church in the house of Priscilla and Aquila, and another church here in which Philologus and Julia, Nerus and his sister, and Olympus met together with other believers. Then he concluded this passage by saying, greet one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ greet you. And I'm sure we hear this verse, greet one another with a holy kiss. We hear it in every divine liturgy. And in the divine liturgy, we took this, greet one another, this response, greet one another with a holy kiss, from the epistle of St. Paul to Romans. The word holy kiss means a kiss that has no lust in it. A pure kiss, and also a kiss that has no betrayal in it, not like the kiss of Judas. So it is a pure kiss, and also there is no hypocrisy in it, there is no betrayal in it. This kiss is a sign of reconciliation, a sign of love. And why we include it in the Divine Liturgy? Because we cannot be in communion with Christ. We cannot reconcile with Christ unless we are reconciled with one another. That's why in the beginning of the liturgy of the believers, the deacon instructs us to greet one another with a holy kiss. And greet one another doesn't mean we greet those who are sitting next to me. But greet one another means that I should be able to greet any person in my life, whether he is sitting next to me or not, whether he is worshiping with me in the same church or not. But this means my heart doesn't hold any grudges against anybody. That's why he says the churches of Christ greet you. It is a symbol of reconciliation, of love, the Christian love, which is the bond of perfection that we should have with one another. From verse 17 to 20, St. Paul gives them another warning to avoid the person who are making divisions in the church. And at that time, St. Paul was referring to the false teachers, especially those who were from Jewish background. And they were teaching that unless you keep the law of Moses, you cannot be saved. That's why St. Paul said, "Now I urge you, brethren, not those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them." Not them who cause divisions and offenses. And they teach contrary to the doctrines, to the dogmas that I taught you, and avoid them. So the false teachers who were disturbing the churches of the Gentiles, St. Paul was urging the believers to isolate them and to avoid them, not to listen to them and not to mingle with them. And maybe some people will ask here, how few minutes ago we were speaking about reconciliation, and now St. Paul is saying, telling us, avoid them. So is this avoidance against the spirit of reconciliation? Can we avoid somebody, or this is considered against the spirit of reconciliation? Actually, we are called to avoid those who cause divisions and also those who do not repent. As in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, St. Paul made it very clear when he said, verse 11, "But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother." Named a brother means a Christian, who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. Not even to eat with such a person. So St. Paul was very clear. We have to avoid those who are causing divisions and those who are not repenting. And I want to tell you, this is not against the spirit of reconciliation, but this concept is what we call it, the concept of tough love. Because I love them, that's why I avoid them. Avoid them, and this may lead them to repentance. And this is exactly what happened with the sinner at the church of Corinth. When they excommunicated him, when they avoided him, when they did not mingle with him, when he felt isolated from the body of Christ, the church of God, he repented. And when he repented, St. Paul instructed them to receive him with love. So maybe we need at certain time to avoid or to isolate some people. And by avoiding them, actually we are sending them a message that unless you repent, you cannot be saved. And this message will help them in their repentance, and they will return back to God. Also avoiding them to protect us from being influenced by them. St. Paul said, bad company corrupt good morals, which implies that I should not keep bad company. I should not listen to false teachers. Because many believers think it is okay to go to different denominations and listen to the teaching. And they say, no, I know what's right and what's wrong. I will listen, but I will not be affected. This is deception from Satan. St. Paul very clearly said here, I want you to note those who cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, which means those who are teaching different teaching than the doctrine in the gospel. And you need to avoid them. Avoid them. Don't go and listen to their teaching. Don't go and listen to their preaching. You need to avoid them. Verse 18. For those who are such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly. St. Paul is saying the false teachers are not devoted to serve the Lord. Why? Because if they are twisting the teaching of the Lord, if they are not teaching the truth, then they are not serving Christ, but serving their own selves. Maybe they want to be famous. Maybe they are hungry for money. Maybe they just fulfill and satisfy their own desires. That's why he said they serve their own belly. And by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple. So they use smooth words and flattering speech. They are able to deceive the simple. Simple means the innocent and the non-suspecting. That's why we should be very careful. As I usually say, the power of Satan lies in his ability to deceive. And if Satan lost his ability to deceive, he will be powerless. And those who are his servant, the servant of Satan, they use the same technique. By smooth words and flattering speech, deceive the hearts of the simple. Be watchful. Don't be deceived. Avoid those who are teaching contrary to the doctrine that we received from the fathers. You need to avoid them, otherwise you will be deceived. Verse 19, for your obedience has become known to all. St. Paul is telling them, your reputation as good Christian is so well known that you ought not to be deceived by these false teachers. Your reputation is so well known. So you need to be a good example. If other churches heard that you in Rome are listening to false teachers, maybe they will also listen to the false teachers. So also, even if you are strong, but don't put a stumbling block before others. Even if you are able to discern between the false and the truth, but don't put a stumbling block before others. For your obedience has become known to all. Therefore, I am glad on your behalf. I am glad that you are strong in Christ. I am glad that you are able to discern between the falsehood and the truth. You are strong and nobody can deceive you easily. I am glad for you all. But I want you to be wise in what is good and simple concerning evil. This is a very, very wise advice from St. Paul. I want you to be simple in evil, to be children in evil. But when it comes to wisdom, I want you to be wise. As the Lord Jesus Christ said, be wise as serpents, but be simple and harmless like doves. When the Lord Jesus Christ said, unless you convert and be like children, he did not mean children in your minds, but he meant children in evil, to be innocent. But in mind, you need to be wise. You need to be wise in what's good and simple concerning evil. So you need the wisdom to discriminate between truth and error. But with regard to evil, you need to be ignorant like the simple and the children. Verse 20, and God of peace. Again, St. Paul is speaking about people who are causing division. That's why he's describing God as God of peace. God who is able to keep the peace in the church. The peace with one another. God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. Crush Satan means will give you victory over Satan and over his soldiers who are causing divisions and causing a schism in the church. So do not be afraid of them, because Jesus Christ crushed Satan at the cross. And by crushing Satan at the cross, he made peace between us and God, between the Jews and the Gentiles, between the person and himself. So in the same way, God of peace will crush Satan who is causing the division in the church and will keep the unity and the harmony of the church. God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So don't be afraid. The grace of God is with you. And you need this grace. And this grace will help you to overcome Satan and also to overcome those who are causing division. So we must fight with a certain hope of victory. From verse 21, those who were with St. Paul in Corinth, the companions of St. Paul, now are sending their greeting to the church in Rome. And it's very interesting that St. Paul did not mention Peter. So if Peter was in Rome, if St. Peter was in Rome, do you think that St. Paul will not mention him? Certainly he would mention him. So the fact that St. Peter is not mentioned in this list of greeting means that St. Peter was not in Rome. And who established the church in Rome? It is St. Paul, because St. Paul went to Rome before Peter. So St. Paul actually is the one who established the church in Rome, not St. Peter. St. Peter, after St. Paul, went to Rome. But the first one who ministered to Rome, as we read in Acts chapter 28, the last verse, was St. Paul. And as I told you, if Peter was in Rome at that time, definitely Paul would mention him in this list of greeting. Verse 21, Timothy, my fellow worker. So Timothy was with St. Paul at that time in Corinth, as we read in Acts chapter 20, verse 4. So Timothy also is sending his greeting to the church in Rome. And Lucius, Jason, and Sosipater, my countrymen, greet you. Countrymen, again, means they were Jewish. Lucius possibly also of Cyrene, the one who is mentioned in Acts chapter 3, chapter 13, verse 1. Lucius, possibly of Cyrene, the one who is mentioned in Acts chapter 13, verse 1. Jason, possibly the one that was mentioned in Acts chapter 17, verse 5. And Sospater is the same as Sopater that was mentioned in Acts chapter 20, verse 4. So these three persons were mentioned in Acts. And as I told you, countrymen means they were Jews. Verse 21. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, greet you in the Lord. As you know, St. Paul's vision was weak. That's why he didn't write by himself. He used to dictate a letter, and somebody writes by his hand. So Tertius is the one who wrote the letter, is the one who actually wrote the letter. And St. Paul dictated the letter to him. Phoebe is the one who carried the letter to Romans. She did not write it. The one who wrote it is Tertius. And Phoebe carried the letter to Rome. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, greet you in the Lord. Verse 23, Gaius, my host and the host of the Holy Church greets you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 14, we know that St. Paul baptized Gaius at Corinth. And Gaius was known for his hospitality. That's why after St. Paul baptized him, Gaius hosted St. Paul in his house. That's why he said, Gaius, my host, and the host of the Holy Church, as I told you, who is known with his hospitality. So Gaius from Corinth greets you. Erastus, the treasurer of the city, greets you, and Quartus, a brother. Erastus, the city treasurer, means a man of high position, but believed in Christ, sending also his greeting to the church in Rome. Erastus was mentioned in Acts chapter 19, verse 21, and 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 20. And also another believer, Quartz, in the church of Corinth, sending his greeting. Verse 24, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. In verse 20, we read the same word, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Why St. Paul is repeating it again in verse 24? Why the benediction, grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, is repeated twice? One time in verse 20 and the other time in verse 24. The first one, he dictated to Tertius, and Dictaeus wrote it. But St. Paul used to write his name, to sign the letter by his own handwriting, and maybe give his benediction. So in verse 24, these words were written by the hand of St. Paul. And we learned this from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 17, that St. Paul liked to write or sign by his own hands. And he gave the final benediction by his own handwriting. The last three verses in this chapter are doxology, a hymn of praise to God. Verse 25, now to him, to God, who is able to establish you according to my gospel. So now St. Paul is commending them to God. He is saying, now I will close this letter, but now I commend you to God. God who is able to establish you. God who is able to confirm you. God who is able to protect you from going astray. I am commending you to the hand of God. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel, according to the gospel of Christ whom I am preaching, according to the gospel of Christ, the good news of salvation that I am preaching you. That's what he meant by my gospel, the gospel of salvation. And preaching of Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ whom I preached to you to believe in him. According to the revelation of the mystery kept secret since the world began. What mystery here? The mystery that St. Paul is referring to is the mystery of salvation of the Gentiles. St. Paul usually, as in the letter to Ephesians, he said God had a plan even before the foundation of the world to save the Gentiles. But this mystery was not revealed unless in the New Testament, after the incarnation and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this mystery was kept secret since the world began. But in the fullness of time, after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and after he sent the disciple to preach the whole world, this mystery of the salvation of the Gentiles is revealed to everybody. So St. Paul is saying to God, who is able to establish you, according to my good news, according to my gospel, to the good news that I told you, that Christ has a plan to save you, you Gentiles, and preaching of Jesus Christ. That's why I came to preach Jesus Christ to you, to believe in him and to be saved. According to the revelation, because God revealed this mystery, God revealed that he loves the Gentiles also. His love is not only for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles. According to the revelation, he revealed this mystery that was kept secret since the world began. But now, verse 26, but now made manifest. Now God revealed this mystery. This mystery is manifest now. And by the prophetic scriptures, made known to all nations. So this mystery actually was written in the prophecies of the prophets, was written in the scripture, but people couldn't understand it. But now after the mystery was revealed, now we can go and read like Isaiah 19:19, blessed my people Egypt. Now we know that God had a plan to save the Gentiles. That's what he said. And by the prophetic scriptures, now we can understand the prophecies that were written in the scripture. And this was made known to all nations. This mystery was made known to all nations. Everybody in the whole world knows that God loves everybody, the Jews and the Gentiles. Everybody is called for salvation. According to the commandment of the everlasting God for obedience to faith. This is the commandment of God. This is the commandment of God. God commanded St. Paul to be an apostle to the Gentiles. So actually the foundation of the apostolic office of St. Paul was according to the commandment of God. In order to obey, in order for the Gentiles to obey the faith, that he meant for the obedience to the faith, in order for the Gentiles to obey the faith and believe in Christ. Although this is a new dispensation But God never changes. It's a new dispensation to us, but this is known to God even before the foundation of the world. That's why he used the word everlasting God to say God did not change his mind in the New Testament and decided to save the Gentiles. No, he is everlasting. So this mystery was before the world began, but it is revealed to us in the fullness of time. So this was known to God So it is known to God all his works and every variation of them from eternity. There is no new knowledge to God. Made known to all nations mean that they don't only knew Christ, but also they enjoy believing in him and they enjoy this salvation. That's why he said, for obedience to the faith. The last verse, verse 27, to God, alone wise, be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. Again, he is describing God here as wise, alone wise, because every wisdom is taken from God. You know, the word wisdom in Greek means Sophia. So the Greek philosophers said, I cannot describe myself Sophos, the wise. I cannot describe myself Sophos, wise. Because God is the only wise who is alone wise. But how we describe ourselves? We describe ourselves lovers of wisdom. Lover means philo. Wisdom means Sophia. So lover of wisdom means what? Philosophia, philosopher. So when we say philosophy or we say philosopher, he is a lover of wisdom, because only God is the wise. God who is alone wise. So actually the word philosopher is a word of humbleness. When I say this man or this person is philosopher, or I say I'm a philosopher, it's not a word of pride as it is used right now, but it's a word of humbleness. Means I cannot describe myself as wise, because only God is alone wise. But I am just a lover of wisdom. Philosophia. Philosophy. Philosopher. A lover of wisdom. God is alone wise. And remember, he instructed them in verse 19 to be wise. So as if he is saying, if you want to be wise in what is good, then get this wisdom from God, because God is alone wise. To him glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. Through Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ revealed the love of God to us. He declared the love of God to us. So through Jesus Christ, we give glory to God the Father, glorify him for his love, for his mystery to save us, for this plan and this economy to consider us his people and his family and to save all of us. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.